Hey guys, so we've just finished filming the travel photography series with Matt Parry around India. And before I go home, I thought it'd be nice to do a quick vlog about some of the kit that I use to film this sort of series and the kit that I've been using. So the camera I've been using is the A7S Mark II. And I tend to go for this camera for this sort of work because a lot of the time, obviously, we're doing travel photography. So a lot of the time that we're filming and shooting will be sort of golden hour, blue hour. And I really need to use a camera that I know that is gonna be able to hold up in low light scenarios and be able to push the ISO up without the image deteriorating. And that's where the A7S really does excel. As you all know, this thing is a low light monster. This camera I absolutely love using for this sort of work. The lens that I've been using on it throughout the entire project isn't actually this one. This is the 24-70 G Master, but I've actually been using the 24-105 F4. Now you're probably thinking, why am I using a lens that is slower than this G Master, which I clearly have in possession? Well, one, I don't need to be filming and shooting at f2.8 when I'm doing running gun documentary style work. If I'm shooting at f2.8 on this full frame sensor, it's gonna make my life extremely difficult in trying to get it in focus. So f4 is more than enough for me anyway, for this sort of work. Now also, you get that extended reach as well, 24-105 as opposed to 24-70, which again, when I'm just having the one lens, I don't want to be changing lenses because a lot of the time I'm just reacting to the situation that's happening. You know, none of this is planned, we're just sort of seeing what happens, seeing what photo opportunities come up. Having that extra reach just makes, again, my life easier. Obviously, looking at this A7S, it's been rigged slightly. So I've got the Manfrotto cage. These are the new cages that they've released. In conjunction with wooden camera, hence the wooden handle, allows me to rig accessories on there. So this handle can be mounted on the side like this, which is how I personally have it, because I can op the camera like this, get my focus, and then if Matt isn't moving or the presenter isn't moving, I can then grab the handle and have a much more comfortable, stable shot holding it this way. You can also mount the handle on the front, on the side. It's customizable to however you want, and you've got another shoe mount there on the side as well, should you need it for, let's say, another mic pack. On the top, I've got the Sony K2M XLR adapter with the ECM microphone that comes with it. I think it's good enough to use as your main shotgun mic. On the top, I've got the Rode Filmmaker kit, and that's Matt's main mic, which is attached to him under his shirt using the Rycoach stickies and undercovers. But I've also got this Zoom H1. This little microphone recorder, this came out years ago. I think there's actually a new version that just came out. I did literally have this as a backup if I need the extra mic that I don't want to be attached to the camera, or if should any of these mics pack up, I've got this. And it means I can also run in one of the wireless lavalier systems into the input here, and then I can record that as well onto this. Let's move on to how I'm shooting and the storage. Now a lot of it is, actually nearly all of the shots that are in this series have all been done handheld, because we're moving around. You know, a lot of the time I'm not setting up a tripod because I'm not allowed to, which I'll move on to in a second. So it's all handheld and it's all shot in 4K, 25 frames a second, and I deliver the project in HD because I think that shooting in 4K, from what I've seen, gives me much more detailed images when it's downsampled into 1080p. It also means if you're bumping up the ISO, eventually if you do get some noticeable noise, when that 4K footage is shrunken down to 1080p, that noise is going to be less visible and less noticeable. But of course, shooting in 4K will have its drawbacks. Even though we are still shooting compressed, you're still going to use up quite a bit of memory over the course of 1 week of traveling and filming. So I have all my spare SD cards here. And basically what I do, once one card's full, I'll put it face down in here, and you can see how much we've used. And these are pretty much all like 128 gig, the Extreme Pro SanDisk cards. And once it's face down, when we get back to a hotel or accommodation, I'll then put that into my MacBook Pro, log all that footage, make a copy locally onto the MacBook Pro, and then I'll also make a copy onto a lazy rugged drive as well. So then I've got three sort of locations where that footage is physically stored. I've been using this, it's called the OmniCharge, and it's basically a power bank, and it's one of the best that I've ever used. The unique thing about this power bank is that you can charge over USB, which is pretty standard. You've got two ports at the front, but it can also output a mains power supply. On the right hand side here, it comes with a whole host of adapters, And basically I can run my MacBook off it, and I can also charge the Sony batteries from it or my phone, wherever you are. And it is really super powerful. I'd definitely check out the details in the description to check this thing out, because, you know, power banks are not really the sexiest item, but once you've invested in a decent one, then you're gonna be good for a long time then. And then moving on to this, which is the Tire Light by Blind Spot Gear. Now, I didn't plan on using a light on this trip. Obviously there's plenty of light here, it's India. So, you know, right now I'm filming this, it's 39 degrees, so I'm probably not looking the most flattering on camera here. But sometimes you never know when you might need that extra bit of light. And for the size, it's well worth just popping in your bag, and it's built like a tank. It's actually quite powerful as well, so I've got it running off a Sony battery. Got a gel on the front to make it tungsten. And it just means if you're ever doing an interview, you don't want to be caught out and not having enough light. This thing's actually quite powerful for its size. You can't just take a tripod into any of the historical monuments here in India. In fact, they're super paranoid about even taking cameras that are rigged up like this. And it's another reason why I stick with the A7S for this job particularly, because once it's all de-rigged and it's just the camera body, you can still shoot a beautiful video. I still like to have a tripod with me, because the last thing that I would want is to be caught out at a moment where I think, wow, that'd be nice to get a locked off shot there. But at the same time, you don't want to be lugging around a big, heavy video tripod whilst you're traveling around the likes of India, 39 degrees heat, because that is just going to be unpleasant, especially if you don't even know if you're going to be using it. But like I say, I still like to have one, and I've been using the Manfrotto B3 tripod, super lightweight. Obviously when it's extended to its highest, it's not going to be the most sturdiest of tripods, and it's in no way going to be able to compete with, you know, your big traditional style of tripods. But for travel, this thing is great. When you pair it with the Manfrotto cage that we've got here, you don't actually need to mount a plate. It's got one built into the bottom. But the nice thing about the tripod is that it's actually got a ball balancing head, which a lot of the smaller tripods don't have, so you don't have to be fiddling around with the legs to try and make it balanced. You might notice that this strap dangling off my camera, and that's because when you're walking and whatnot, when you're not filming, you don't want to be carrying the camera all the time. It's going to give you some tired wrists, so you do need a good camera strap to just give yourself a breather. I've been using the Sun Sniper strap, super comfortable. Does get a bit sweaty in this sort of heat, but you know, all parts of my body are sweating in this sort of heat. Sorry for giving you too much information there. But it's very comfortable, very secure, and it's got this ball joint here, so it's quite ergonomic when it's on your side and when you just want to grab it up. Now, of course, all of this stuff, which this is only really a fragment of the things that I have, these are just the talking points that I wanted to talk to you about. Of course, I've got lots of little bits and bobs of audio cables, adapters, plenty of spare batteries for the A7S because they run relatively quick. I think I have about 8 of them that I just keep topping up once one's depleted. I'll then hook it up to this if it's in my bag, get that one charged up, and just keep the system going, so I've always got a whole bunch of fresh batteries should I need them. But they all need to be housed in something for me to carry all of this gear with, and I've been using this. It's the Manfrotto Advanced Travel Backpack, and for its price, it's actually incredibly useful in the amount of things that you can carry. I can fit all of this gear, the two camera bodies, the spare wireless lavalier, this microphone, XLR adapter, the chargers, the lights, all my bits and bobs can go in this quite comfortably, and there's plenty of padding in there so I can make sure that things are all sort of segregated and sectioned off. If you opt to use the B3 travel tripod, then this bag is designed to be used in conjunction with that, and on the side pocket here is for a tripod, and it's built for the B3 tripod. So this tripod packs down, fits perfectly into this side pocket, and it just means that if you're traveling, instead of having a tripod that's, you know, banging on the back, on the side, hitting your legs, or a big video tripod, this one just neatly tucks away into your backpack. So it's less of an issue if you're not sure if you're going to use it, but you still want to take it. This bag's going to perfectly house it. So anyway, I hope that's been interesting for you guys to see the equipment that I use to shoot this sort of project. You know, a lot of the work will be in the edit now, pulling it all together. But if you've got any questions about some of the kit, some of the decisions that I've made as to why I would use them, do leave a question in the comments and I'll get back to you. Other than that, I hope you've enjoyed the series. If you've not seen it, check it out on YouTube. And for more video tutorials, reviews, tips and tricks, head over to wex.co.uk.